This entitled mom thinks she's found a loophole to receive free babysitting for life, but the employee she's trying to mess with won't let her get away with it. Happy birthday, today's your birthday, and on with the revamped show. I have lived in multiple tourist cities throughout my life, meaning I have had to deal with parking being a premium thing repeatedly. I grew up in a city known as a tourist hotspot. Because of that, and because I wasn't about to put up with issues with parking yet again, when I moved to my fourth tourist hotspot, I paid for two spots, one close to my apartment and one just a ways away. Why two spots, you ask? Parking is a premium, and guest parking is limited. Not only that, but I live far from family, and they need the spot when they visit. My dad agreed with me and forks over half the bill, just so he doesn't have the fight for parking either. In total, for the two spots, we fork over $155 a month. Yesterday morning, I leave to go get groceries and run some errands. It's my weekend, and I needed supplies. Anyway, on my drive back, I see entitled neighbor getting out of her car in my second spot. I roll down my window and inform her that I'm having dinner guests, and I would have let her use my spot had she asked, but I need her to move her car by 5 p.m. It was like 3 p.m. at the time. She gave me the bird, and she said some choice words I won't repeat in my general direction. I also try to ask her why she is using my spot when she has her own, but she doesn't respond, and walks her entitled butt into the building. I go to move to my other spot, about 10 or 11 car spaces down the lot and around the corner of the building, and find someone else is parked in my main spot. I recognize the car as belonging to her friend, who comes over frequently and doesn't ask to take spots. I then realize that all the guest spots and every neighbor who's not home and has a spot is taken by unknown cars and with the windows down. Quickly figure out she's hosting a rowdy party and was too entitled to care that she and her guests are taking paid for parking spots. While I'm sitting there in my car for a minute, contemplating what to do and whom to contact, my neighbor across the hall's youngest daughter, age 16, comes running from the building and goes straight for my car. I let her in, and she begins to cry, distraughtly about what's been going on since her mum left, about the same time as me to run errands, which would have been like 1 p.m. She couldn't reach her mum, and because of these people, she was too scared to call for help. I was not. I called a friend in law enforcement and asked a few choice questions about removing the car. She advised that seeing as the parking spot is rightfully mine, I could just tell the property manager what was happening and then have the cars in my spots towed for illegally parking. So I decided that was the plan I was going with. I then called up every single neighbor that I had a number for who I saw had their spot taken, three of them. I had the girl call the other neighbors so they could check their spots too. That seemed to calm her down. When we got the property manager on the phone, totaling 8 illegally parked unknown cars with 7 plus angry residents making the calls to him. He took our side and started calling tow companies. At 5 p.m. on the dot, a gaggle of tow trucks, four of them in a row, arrived. This was due to the fact that I'd warned the lady I needed her out of the spot by 5, so just to be safe, we went with this route per the suggestion of the property manager. At 5:30 p.m, entitled neighbor's friend, and two other cars were towed from the lot, with property manager directing which cars. I finally got to bring my car into a designated spot. At this point, it was down the street over a block away, if anyone's wondering where I parked the car during this. Entitled neighbor didn't notice. The other four cars were towed less than half an hour later. I don't know why none of them noticed. Her freaking place faces the street and had to see the cars being towed. At this point, I canceled my plans with my friends because I didn't want to have them be introduced to my entitled neighbor, as I knew she'd blow up if the bird and cursing and treatment of my neighbor's daughter were any indication. Somehow, three neighbors, property manager, and property manager's brother, who live at far end of the complex in another building, ended up in my place, and we chowed down on some pizza neighbor across the hall picked up on her way home. We all awaited the expected blow up. 6:30 p.m. Cue the angry pounding on the door and the smashing of my doorbell. As I'm getting up to answer, the property manager tells me to sit and goes to the door with his brother and two of the male neighbors, who have been in the complex for like 5 years. He opens the door and stares at the woman, who is flabbergasted as to why he's in my place, and then I can hear her demanding to talk to me. My property manager informs her that if she so much as tries to talk to me, touch me, or harass me in any fashion, he will have her arrested, and then goes on to do the same for the other seven neighbors who have had to have cars towed out of their spots. and their families, and warns that the same fact to her angry friends whose vehicles were towed. He also tells the group, again it's like 10 entitled adults she had over, that if they touch any of the cars parked in their paid for spots, the lots are videotaped, and he has no problem bringing police over to arrest for vandalism and trespassing. If you're gonna break the rules of the apartment complex by bringing that many people over, at least use a little bit of subtlety. If you're gonna steal someone's parking spot and then you flip them the bird and cuss them out, you're gonna kinda draw a little bit of attention to yourself. I'd be super cautious too, like if I knew 8 cars were parked illegally, I'd be looking out every 5 minutes to check if they're about to be towed. And why would you want to party with that kind of stress anyway? Anyway, I'm glad they got kicked out. They sound like terrible neighbors. It happened more than once at the water park resort I worked at for a year or so. Let me preface this story by mentioning I'd been working with kids for over 10 years at this point, both in daycare and in the entertainment sector. Some backstory. The local water park resort I worked at was geared towards families, so we had an area where kids and their parents could come and do crafts together. It had little tables with crayons and free coloring pages and books to read. We also offered several paid activities, such as ceramics to paint and t-shirts to dye. Let's call it the kids club. I was told by several co-workers upon being hired that parents were fond of trying to drop their children off at the kids club, only to wander off and abandon them. This resulted in one of the employees on duty, there were usually two of us, having to chase the parent down to inform them they had to stay with their kids. Children over the age of 13 were allowed to come in on their own, but only an adult could supervise younger children. This will be relevant later. I was on my game from day one, and families loved me. Even when I had to deal with EPs, I could be so frustratingly sweet and firm that they'd eventually relent. I'm a pretty tall guy, so I assume most parents simply felt they couldn't push me around. This one family came in, a mother, entitled mother, and her probably 5-year-old son, a nice kid. She crouches down and tells him to have fun before making her way to the door. "Excuse me, ma'am, you can't leave your son here. You've got to stay with him.
He's just colouring. He won't be a hassle. And I'll be downstairs at the bar if you need me."
And we're delighted to have him. But per company policy, we can't allow children under 13 to be in here by themselves. I apologise.
"Fine."
The mother takes her son and leaves. I think that's the end of it. But then the kid returns, this time with his sister, who looks about 13 or 14, and isn't entirely happy about the situation. She had a wand in her hand, which was used to play the magic themed game we had all around the resort. I figured her mother must have pulled her away from her game to make her watch her brother. The nice kid excitedly returns to the table where he'd been coloring. I looked to the sister. "Is your mother with you?"
"No, she's not. She said I could be in here with him by myself."
I'm afraid she misinterpreted. You can be in here without supervision, but if your brother wants to play in here, your mum has to be with him.
"I'll go tell her then. Come on, NK."
The kid looked pretty sad to be pulled away from his art again. So I went over and grabbed some crayons for him. I held them out with a smile. "Here you go, buddy. Just bring these back when you're done with them. And only use them on paper, okay?" He smiles.
"Thank you."
Once more, I assume things are done. Even if the kid didn't bring back the crayons, it was fine. They were just crayons, and I had made a kid happy. Oh, how wrong I was. The next day, I'm working the morning shift. I had worked in the afternoon the day before. Entitled Mum comes in with her son. She balks at seeing me sitting at the room, sorting out crayons.
"What are you doing here?"
Putting on my best service smile. "I work here, ma'am. Are you going to color with your son today? Or would you like to do some of our paid activities?"
"Why can't I just leave him here? You've got nothing better to do. You're just messing with the crayons."
She smiles, convinced she's bested me. Even if it is company policy, she's right. The kids club was pretty dead, as it was a slow weekday. She hadn't counted on me being experienced with the daycare system. "Ma'am, I cannot do that. Not only is it company policy, but this kids club is not in any way certified as a daycare. We don't have emergency contact information. We are not trained in CPR, which is regulatory for daycare workers, nor are we equipped to be qualified as a daycare. This room has one single exit, a clear violation of building code for any basic childcare facility. I'm the only one on duty, and while I do have various certifications and a degree, I was hired to be an entertainer, not a daycare worker. If you leave your son here, I will call
call security, because not only will it violate my contract, but you would be participating in willful neglect of your child. We have signs posted that all children must be accompanied by an adult, and now I have informed you of this no less than 2 times. Your son is absolutely welcome here, but you must stay with him. She was shocked. I don't know if it was due to the unsettling customer service tone I took with her, or the fact that I was obviously up to date on childcare regulations. Either way, she shut her trap, sat in one of our tiny chairs, and let her son color. Her son and I read stories together too, but I made sure she remained in the room. We weren't a daycare, and I'd be darned if I let her treat us like one. I found out later that she tried to complain about me, but seeing as how we had video surveillance that showed her trying to leave her child more than once, the complaint was thrown out and not put on my record. I understand why parents would try to do this. Of course, if you can get free babysitting, you know, why wouldn't you? But they're not really thinking through the consequences. Like they said, it is actually neglecting the children. There's probably legal ramifications there. So it seems like a simple, nice, they'll just take care of my kid for a few hours, could actually end up being a pretty serious thing that would get police involved. But why on earth would we ever expect an entitled parent to think about consequences? My cousin got married some years ago, and soon his wife was pregnant, giving joy to all relatives. In my country, naming your children after the grandparents is still a strong tradition, and in case you don't want to keep it, you better have open-minded in-laws. I have a whole bunch of stories where the two pair of grandparents start whole family wars, manipulate, demand, and pressure their children over a matter that is, after all, not theirs to decide. But I distinguish this story as an even more cruel case. Here is how my cousin's father acted like an entitled parent of the worst kind. Since the beginning, he considered it a given that the baby, no matter the gender, would take his name. My cousin preferred to be diplomatic and kept saying, "We'll see," for the time being. This particular pregnancy was sadly a difficult case all along, and led to a premature birth of the baby, who had to spend another 3 months in the incubator. The parents were devastated and struggled day by day to keep their courage and not sink in despair. The intensive care phase was over, and at last they could take their beloved son home. But it took some more months for his health to stabilize and to be completely out of danger. Everyone was happy and relieved. Then the time for the christening came. With all the joy and merriment of planning the big day, entitled grandpa heard that the couple decided for another name and was furious. He used every possible means to make his son and daughter-in-law feel horrible. He was cold during family dinner. He was passive-aggressive, used every possible direct and indirect way to show how he was disappointed, how the wrong name choice was a sign of disrespect and an insult against him. Such inconsiderate and abusive behavior against his own family, against two parents who had already been through so much emotionally because of the fragile condition of their baby. At some point, he clearly stated that if they don't name the grandson after him, he will disown him. Even so, my cousin refused to give in. One evening, before the christening ceremony, entitled grandpa visits his son and asks if they insist on the other name. My cousin calmly says, "Yes." So entitled grandpa, in an equally calm tone, says,
"Son, you remember, I'm sure, this wise ancient Greek saying, the sins of the fathers are visited upon the children." And then silence. By saying that, he was suggesting that the future of his grandson would be hard as he would be disowned, and that it was all because of my cousin's stubborn resistance to his wish.
Entitled grandpa chose this cruel, dirty blackmail to make his son feel guilty for whatever bad would follow and being supposedly selfish, while clearly he was the selfish one and made a huge deal out of pure vanity. The couple was tortured by doubts and second thoughts all night long, and at last minute, they gave the child both names. Entitled grandpa is still proud that he had it his way. Well, I can't promise that they all have happy endings, but hopefully this is a lesson to us. I think we can often feel compelled into following the traditions of our parents, grandparents, society, but each of us has to rationalize and think about what makes sense for us. It's really sad that this family member used manipulation, emotional blackmail, and essentially tried to curse them, I guess, into getting his way, and had the nerve to call them selfish. And this is why we fight EPs, my friends. This is why we do it.
Submit your story to be read on the channel at voiceyhearstories@gmail.com and join our Voicey veteran community at r/voiceyhere. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell to never miss an episode. All right, Voicey veterans, I'll see you in the next one.